Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Lesions in cancer.
Yes, sir.
So we go on to do this topic, which is the genetic lesions in cancer. So what does it mean is, these are the common genetic abnormalities you see in any form of cancer. Okay, and it keeps changing between the cancer phenotype, whatever it might be. So each phenotype shows a different genetic lesion than the other. But there are a few common findings which you can identify in any form of cancer is uncontrolled proliferation. That tumor cell continues to proliferate without any control and it grows without any
सर आवाज नहीं आ रही आपकी हेलो
हेलो कैन यू हियर मी
सर आवाज
यस
अभी अभी आ रही
सो दीज जेनेटिक लीशंस आर डिफरेंट बिटवीन डिफरेंट कैंसर्स बट द कॉमन पॉइंट इज दैट दीज लीशंस विल शो अनकंट्रोल्ड प्रोलिफरेशन दैट इज द इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट व्हिच यू मस्ट रियलाइज ओके So these genetic lesions, there are two things which you must know. One is called a driver mutation. The other one is called a passenger mutation. So what is the meaning of a driver and a passenger? You all know. Okay, driver is the person, say imagine you are going in a car. The person who is taking the car, controlling where the car goes left or to the right, whether it stops or whether it goes back in reverse, all is controlled by the driver. Okay, so these are the driver mutations which are responsible for cancer formation, cancer progression. Okay, then you have passenger mutation. Passenger mutation is something which is seen on the side. It's something like a passenger in your car. So if the driver is turning the car to the right, the passenger cannot go to the left. He has no other choice but to go along with the driver. So that is the main thing. Driver mutations are mutations that alter the function of cancer genes and directly contribute to the development or progression of a cancer. So whenever there is going to be a driver mutation, it means that driver mutation is directly responsible for the formation or progression of a given cancer. Whereas the passenger mutations are acquired mutations that are neutral in terms of fitness and do not affect cellular behavior. So passenger mutations are seen in the DNA genome along with the primary mutation that are responsible for cancer. But these passenger mutations do not do anything specific when the cancer is growing. But what happens is these passenger mutations are important when this mutational analysis has been done. So mutational analysis means it is a procedure by which you check the DNA of a cancer cell to identify the areas of damage. So these passenger mutations will increase the overall mutation score. Even though they are not directly responsible for cancer genesis, they will show like all the defective areas where can be a potential risk factor for carcinogenesis. Then they create genetic variants that can provide tumor cell with a selective advantage during therapy. That is very important because nowadays tumor cells are being treated with targeted therapy. You have specific drugs that target specific genetic mutations. These passenger mutations can prevent those cancer cells from getting damaged by these drugs. So these passenger mutations are important to protect the cancer cell from getting affected by cancer therapy. So that is the importance of this, your passenger mutation. So one, you have driver mutation, which is responsible for formation or progression of cancer. The second one is called passenger mutation, which is seen along with a cancer cell, but it is important for determining the response of the cancer cell to therapy. The third one is called point mutation. Point mutation means it is either activation or inactivation of the protein product of the activated gene based on its position and consequence in the DNA genome. So what happens is point mutations are the changes that happens in a specific point inside the DNA. So imagine that point is responsible for conversion of proto-oncogene into an oncogene by producing a gain of function. So what happens is, I told you, proto-oncogenes are ones which control cell proliferation. If this cell proliferation genes go out of control, that is, if there's going to be a mutation that continues expression of these oncogenes, the cell will continue to proliferate without any break. Okay, so this point mutation is very important. Example is point mutation in a RAS gene, which is responsible for most human cancers. So this point mutation is a defect in a single point inside the DNA genome. You get bigger aberration. Bigger aberrations means which you see a visible damage in the cell itself, like insertion or deletion. Insertion of new code or deletion of existing code can also affect the functioning of the effective protein. So the tumor suppressor gene, which I told you that controls the tumor, TP53, is a very important guardian type tumor suppressor gene which gets mutated and the cell stops undergoing apoptosis. Okay, so what happens is if P53 is working normally, it will see a DNA damage, it will ask the cell to undergo apoptosis. If there's going to be a mutation in the P53 genome, what happens is the cells will not undergo apoptosis at all. They will keep on proliferating. So we have seen what is driver mutation, we have seen what is passenger mutation, and we have seen what is a point mutation. The next one is a genetic rearrangement. A gene rearrangement is known as translocation or inversion. Translocation means shift of one portion of the DNA to a some other chromosome, or inversion between the same DNA, that is inversion of the nucleotides. So these translocation inversions are seen in hematopoietic malignancies and some mesenchymal malignancies. So the most important one which you must see is here in this picture. You can see there are two things which are discussed. One is a chronic myelogenous leukemia, and the second one is Burkitt lymphoma. You can see there are two chromosomes where one is normal, the other one is the leukemia chromosome. What you see here is in a normal chromosome, there is, you have chromosome 9, you have chromosome 22. So what happened is the ABL locus of chromosome 9 and the BCR locus of chromosome 22 undergoes a specific genetic change here in this CML. So this CML gene, where this BCR from chromosome 22 fuses with the ABL of chromosome 9, you end up with this BCR-ABL hybrid gene. So this hybrid gene is responsible for activation of growth factors leading to uncontrolled proliferation of hematopoietic cells leading to leukemia. So here chromosome 9, chromosome 22, one portion of chromosome 9 ABL fuses with BCR of chromosome 22, forming a ABL-BCR hybrid gene which undergoes activation of growth factors leading to uncontrolled proliferation. Similarly, if you're going to see in Burkitt's lymphoma, what happens is there is the interaction between chromosome 8 and chromosome 14. Chromosome 8 has a MYC oncogene, it's called MYC. Whereas in chromosome 14, you have the IG, which is your immunoglobulin secreting gene. What happens? So here in Burkitt's lymphoma, you get a translocation where immunoglobulin gene fuses with the MYC oncogene, leading to continuous production of immunoglobulins, which you see in Burkitt's lymphoma. So this is nothing but what you see in genetic rearrangement. So this is what happens when with translocation or inversion, what happens here. Similarly, the other one which you must see is can get fusion of genes leading to production of new chromosomes. So what happens is in Philadelphia chromosome, that is what you see in your CML, this is called a Philadelphia chromosome, where you get a balanced reciprocal translocation between chromosome 9 and chromosome 22, which leads to formation of a hybrid gene producing lot of growth factors leading to a cancer gene. Okay, so this is very important when there is gene rearrangement. So the other one which you must also remember is in myeloid neoplasm like leukemias, myeloproliferative disorders like lymphomas, and even there are some sarcomas you can get gene rearrangement. So the important one is Ewing sarcoma. Ewing sarcoma shows a translocation between chromosomes 11 and 22. So here one is chromosome 9, 22. The other one is chromosome 8, 14. The third one is chromosome 11 and 22. But three are three different malignancies. One is acute or a chronic myeloid CML, chronic myeloid leukemia. Whereas the other one is Burkitt lymphoma, where you see between 8 and 14. So here in Ewing sarcoma, you see between chromosome 11 and 22. Okay, so these are three important genetic rearrangements which you must always remember. So we have seen what is a driver mutation. You have seen what is a passenger mutation. Now you know what is a point mutation. You know what is insertion, what is deletion. You know what is genetic gene rearrangements leading to translocation or inversion. Then you also have deletions, which is a more prevalent abnormality in tumor cells. Deletion of specific region of chromosomes can lead to loss of tumor suppressor gene. As I told you, if there is going to be a point mutation in p53 gene, the cell will not undergo apoptosis. Similarly, there's going to be a deletion of an area that expresses the tumor suppressor genes, the cell will continue to proliferate. So one important one is your RB gene. I told you your RB gene, which is seen in retinoblastoma, which is nothing but an inherited genetic disorder which has higher risk for cancer. There is a deletion in chromosome 13. Chromosome 13 deletion of RB gene is noted. Similarly, in chromosome 17p, there is loss of this p53 gene activity. Okay, so this is very important in deletion. Then the other entity which you must know is called gene amplification. Gene amplification means where a proto-oncogene can be converted to oncogene by gene amplification with consequent overexpression and hyperactivity of otherwise normal proteins. If there's going to be excessive activity of an area, that's called gene amplification. Imagine you have a gene which is responsible for proliferation. It normally produces, say, 10. If there's going to be an amplification, it produces 100. What happens? That 100 will produce increased activity. So this is what you've seen in tumors. Okay, so this gene amplification can be seen in two forms. One is called double minutes. The other one is called homogeneously staining region. So one is called double minutes. The other one is called homogeneous staining regions. Okay, so this is homogeneous staining region can be seen as an obvious defect in gene mapping, whereas double minutes are seen extra chromosomally. That means they are seen outside the chromosome, not in the DNA mapping, whereas a homogeneously staining region can be identified in your DNA mapping. Okay, so this is commonly seen in neuroblastomas and breast cancer. So this amplification areas can be seen in cancer formation. The next entity which you must know is called aneuploidy. Aneuploidy means is defined as a number of chromosome that is not a multiple of the haploid state. That means in humans, the chromosome number is not a multiple of 23. That means in aneuploidy, you don't have the total count of 23 chromosomes per tumor cell. Okay, so this is very important because some portions of the gene is lost, and this aneuploidy will be responsible for cancer formation. How? The mitotic checkpoint prevents aneuploidy by inhibiting the irreversible transition to anaphase until the replicated chromosomes have made attachment to the microtubule. So what does it mean? The cell mitosis, there is a checkpoint that prevents mistakes in separation of the chromosomes, because you know that before a cell divides, the 23 becomes 46 and the 46 is split into 23 each into two daughter cells. So here what happens in a cancer cell, that 23 doubles into 46, or 23 can be split into 25, it can be split into 32, it can be split into 38, whatever it might be, because of irregularities in the checkpoint. Okay, so this is very important in cancer cells. Okay, the next one what you must remember is microRNA. So you already know RNA is ribonucleic acid, which is responsible for conversion of your DNA material into proteins inside a cell. So microRNA are nothing but a non-coding single stranded RNA. That means non-coding, it means that it is not responsible for protein transcription. They are present in the DNA, which they are non-coding as a control mechanism. It is a negative regulator for genes. So if these microRNAs are present, a genetic overexpression can be stopped. Whereas in cancer cell, what happens? These microRNAs are present. Okay, so these microRNA, imagine, is present to control a tumor suppressor gene. A overactivity can reduce the expression of the tumor suppressor protein. So they are also called onco-MIRs. Onco-MIRs are nothing but microRNAs that disable the active functioning of a tumor suppressor gene or expression of a tumor suppressor protein. So this is microRNA and cancer, which is very important in your leukemia. So always remember these genes, RAS gene and MYC gene, are responsible. Similarly, I told you BCL2 is another gene is responsible for apoptosis. If BCL2 is present in a cell, the cell will not undergo apoptosis. It's an anti-apoptotic gene. Okay, so your tumor cell will show increased expression of BCL2. So if there is going to be a mutation in BCL2, the cell will not undergo apoptosis and will continue to survive for longer period of time. Okay, so whenever you read about any cancer, there is always a term which always say epigenetics. Epigenetics are nothing but they are reversible, heritable change in gene expression that occurs without mutation. That means the DNA does not undergo any mutation. These are the factors which are outside the DNA but can regulate post-translational modifications and methylation of proteins, which can affect the expression of genes. So what happens is, these are like factors which control the expression of certain genes by its activity. Okay, so epigenetic modifications are outside the DNA modifications, which I told you before. So whenever there's going to be epigenetic change, usually in tumor cells, these epigenetic changes will favor cancer growth and survival. So they can also cause chromosomal instability and can induce cancers. Okay, to summarize what I've tried to discuss in this lecture is genetic lesions in cancer, starting with mutations of cancer cells falls into two major categories. One is called driver mutation. It's also called pathogenic mutation. They're responsible for cancer development or cancer progression. Then you have passenger mutation or neutral mutation. Neutral mutation means they are identified in the DNA of a cancer cell, but they don't act in direct promotion of cancer, but they can influence the effect of the cancer cell to targeted therapy. Okay, so that is passenger or neutral mutation. Passenger mutations can become driver mutation if there is a selective pressure on the tumor changes. That is, even the setting of treatment with an effective therapeutic drug, say you give a targeted therapy to some cancer cell, this passive passenger mutations can take up a major role and promote tumor survival than a driver mutation. Next, the tumor cells may acquire driver mutation through several means. So this can be point mutation or non-random chromosomal abnormalities like gene arrangement, deletion, amplification. So these are all the other mutations which can induce a driver mutation. So driver mutation can be caused either by point mutation in a genome, can be due to gene rearrangements like translocation, inversion. I told you that can be deletion, amplification. Amplification can be double minutes, or amplification can be your homogeneous staining region. So these gene rearrangements usually are caused by translocations or sometimes by inversion. They contribute by overexpression of oncogenes or generation of new fusion proteins, which has altered signaling that promotes cell proliferation. Deletions are usually affecting the tumor suppressor gene. Gene amplification usually involves the expression of oncogenes. Okay, so there is deletion of a tumor suppressor gene can lead to continued proliferation. Similarly, activation of an oncogene can lead to continuous proliferation. You remember, take a car. Tumor suppressor gene is like a brake. Your oncogene is like an accelerator. So if your car is going to go, either you continuously press the accelerator, the car will keep on rolling, or you don't put the brake also, the car will keep on growing. So that is what the effect happens. Your oncogene is nothing but the accelerator of a car. Your tumor suppressor gene is nothing but a brake in a car. So in a cancer cell, what happens? Somebody is continuously pressing on the accelerator with an oncogene, and the vehicle does not have a brake because tumor suppressor gene does not work. Then you also have microRNAs, which are non-coding RNAs that can influence a cancer cell. Okay. Then you also have the tumor suppressor gene and DNA repair genes can be silenced by epigenetic changes which happen outside the DNA and can influence the methylation and the expression of certain proteins and their target activities. Okay, so this is your genetic lesions in cancer. So I will stop this lecture and I will come back for your discussion. Okay, is that clear? Any doubts? I will come back.
Yes, sir.
Rejoin the session for discussion. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.